60 marathons, and I've only seen one case of somebody overhydrating, but I've seen literally thousands of cases. And those of you that have heard about the horror story in Chicago a few weeks ago where they ran out of water and people didn't have enough, take your water bottle with you, okay? Run with water so that you've got water, you've got Gatorade, whatever you've been using in training, do the same thing. Every 10 minutes, have a sip, not a guzzle, a sip. Because here's the secret for tomorrow. 1 hour before your event, you want to have this much water. This is 500 milliliters of water, okay? So if you have 500 milliliters 1 hour before the event, then what you do is half an hour before your event, you're going to go to the porta potties, okay? Empty your bladder, and then you're still not drinking before the event starts, okay? If you have 500 milliliters, what that does is that does two things. If you've ever drank that much water, you know what it does. It expands your stomach, and it's kind of sloshing there, okay? For that last hour, it'll be sloshing. Half an hour before, you're gonna empty your bladder, the rest will be absorbed into your system. You're gonna have about the right amount of water that you need to start your event.
Try fitting a life richly lived into 400 pages. It's difficult. Try doing it in a 4-minute interview. It's even more difficult. Nonetheless, we're going to give it a go. This is woman's running pioneer, broadcaster, racing promoter, and recently author of, among other books, Marathon Woman, Catherine Switzer. Catherine, it's a pleasure to be with you.
Scott, thanks so much. I'm delighted to be here. And here we are in Niagara Falls. What a great place to run a great race. And what history here is wonderful.
It couldn't be any better. Tell me what led you to, after many years, actually not many years at all, but to write this, and I'm also curious as to how the reaction has been. Have there been some surprises?
Oh, Scott, yeah, the surprises have been great, which is that a lot of guys buy it for their wives or girlfriends thinking it's a girl book, and they are stunned to find, guess what, as runners, we're not just male and female, we're runners together, and I'm getting wonderful feedback from the men, who many of whom didn't understand that amazing history, and a lot of women who didn't know, in the 60s and 70s, you know, we had canvas shoes and no sports bras and no shorts that fit and all kinds of things like that, which parallels the movement and emergence of the sport. And so they're finding it very, very, very interesting in terms of how we have evolved to the point where, you know, here I was being a girl thrown out of the Boston Marathon to now, 40 years later, where there are more registered women runners in North America than men.
It's
so
marvelous.
It's very exciting. And the book itself, Marathon Woman, isn't just about running, really. I mean, of course, that's the metaphor that carries
sure.
it. But it is really about overcoming the impossible, which is what we all feel when we run marathons.
Mm-hmm. It's very much a human story.
Yeah, it very much so is. And it's also very funny because, who could ever imagine that my boyfriend would knock the official flat in the Boston Marathon and I'd go on to finish. And in retelling, that's a funny story. Although at the time it was terrible, it's funny now.
Mm-hmm. Were there any discoveries or anything that surprised you in the process of writing it?
Yeah, your first question you asked me actually was, why did I take so long to write this book? Well, at 60 you can be outrageous, which is wonderful. So I tell the truth and I tell funny things, outrageous things in the book. But I also wanted to tell my own story because it's becoming mythologized over the years. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to get the facts down. And also to do that point in history, which is very, very important to us. But the process of writing, interestingly enough, and you as a writer yourself might know this, is that the brain works and the memory works very much like it does when you train. So that at first it's hard and it doesn't come easily, but then when you get rolling, the training or the memory goes
sure.
faster and faster and gets better and better.
Of course.
And it's interesting that muscles all over the body work that way.
Of course.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in some cases, the actualities are better than the myths. And in this case, we only go through 1984. There might be another book or a follow-up?
I think so. I originally proposed this to my publisher as a 2-volume autobiography. And he says, oh my God. He said, even Bill Clinton can do it in one.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it's this thing. Yeah, there will be a sequel. And probably a little more outrageous.
I was going to say,
61.
With a few more years and a few less inhibitions,
I'll be a little more 61 or 62. And but it's also interesting, you also know this, I'm sure, as a writer, that the process of writing creates other ideas for writing. So I have several other books in mind that I really would like to tackle, things about longevity and the process of staying fit and how it keeps us younger than the general population. And maybe is that a great preventative for disease? Yes, I think so.
Of course.
So I would like to explore those things.
Well, we're looking forward to it. Thank you for spending some time, Catherine.
Thanks, Scott. You're doing a wonderful job. I appreciate it a lot.
Thanks so